trying to find the number for the library for you, but we keep a portion of, we keep all the motor vehicles. The library doesn't get a portion of that. So it's really only that realty category where the library comes into play.
Where we get 3/8 of it?
Yes. So we've...
I think we need to do some kind of showing that, because I think it's a misnomer that we have more money than we actually have, because all we are is a pass-through.
Correct.
And we're really not getting any, we can't use that. So that's not our revenues.
Well, it is our revenue.
It is technically, but I think it has to have some kind of notation showing that we're not actually spending that money, that they're spending that money.
What we have budgeted for the mayor's proposed budget for the library is $13,074,810.
I think we need to show that notation more.
13,074,810.
Thank you.
And we've noted that. That's a good point. Any other questions?
Any other questions?
Right. Okay, so we're going to move on to the third section, which is our services. As Bill discussed last week, the EMS fees has the new Medicare fees in it. I've provided that information to Councilmember Henson per her question last week. I do have that fee schedule if anybody is interested in having that, or happy to email that out to you. With respect to the Medicare, Medicaid reimbursement, I think overall we talked about most of these bullet points. The detention fees, you know, we have a new contract with the U.S. Marshals Services to house inmates, so that's in there. As far as the parks and rec, the $1 increase for golf on the weekdays, $2 increase per round on the weekends, and the $1 increase for aquatics per admission is also factored in there, as Bill discussed last week. And I know Jerry Hancock's here if we have questions specifically regarding that. Sewer usage fees, again, it's based on the CPI, and that's provided for you. So happy to. And then E911, we had an increase of about 4.5% over last year, which is about, it's about $100,000. And the big item is the intergovernmental, the BAB refunds that we talked about last time. That was about $1.14 million, and those are the stimulus dollar refunds that we receive. So I think there were probably more questions in this area and the next area than there were the other two.
Mr. Stennett.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. On the park and recreation program increase, the 16%, what is that? Is that the golf pool fees and closing two pools?
Yes.
Because the math that's been passed out last week doesn't add up to 236. If we say 42,000 on closing Constitution and Berry Hill, plus the 215,000 that's on the sheet that was passed out of fee increases, it's a lot more than 236. So I'm trying to figure out how we get 236,960.
Jerry, do you want to come up and talk about that?
Councilman, I can't speak to exactly that number, but please keep in mind that what we talked about with respect to fee increases for aquatics would generate close to $200,000. We have about 45 revenue items that go into that one number. I'm expecting increases in our Kitty Capers program. We're putting on two special public events that will probably generate $30,000. A few things might go down, so there's a number of things that change that total that. The primary piece of that, however, is aquatics.
I'm just going by the sheet that was passed out on the pools. If we raise, aquatic centers have 185,000 visitors, so a buck increase would be 185,000.
Right.
The other pools have 33,000, a buck increase would be another 33. So You know, if you start doing the math on all those, plus the 42,000 is a lot more than 236. And the reason why I bring this up is because we're getting ready to debate the dollar. So that's going to make a lot of, you know, 50,000 either way is going to be a big number.
Some things would go down and some things would go up. I'm confident that that's a realistic increase in our revenues in that collection of programs.
You know, we just adopted earlier, you know, a $47,000 savings based on the new plan.
Yes.
So there's an additional $5,000 that we found today based on our special counsel meeting. So I'm just trying to figure out what if that's a real number or not.
I believe it is. I'm showing kitty capers, for instance, is going to go up. I don't know what the comparable 10 number was, but it's going to go up $7,000 to $10,000. Again, we're adding about $40,000 in new special event programs, and the pools are going to go up again, depending on when the fee increase is approved or instituted, and how people respond, and more than anything else, what kind of weather we have in June and July. So I thought this is a good number, but we've got two pages of different programs, some of which are going up and down. I'm confident this is an appropriate increase number for next year.
Well, still that doesn't help us. When we're having this discussion on fee increases, $30,000 either way is a big number. You know, we talk about raising rates at pools for a buck. So, I mean, we can when we bring that up, we can go back over that. But I'm getting 265 is the real number if we approve the rate increases. So that's just the difference in math. Not talking about all the other things you're mentioned for income. So I just want to be as close as possible. This is a very tight budget, and a dollar increase can affect a lot of kids going to a pool. And when we debate that here in about an hour, we need to be really clear on all our numbers. So if you all could talk about, make sure these are as best you can get number-wise, because the numbers that were passed out Thursday do not add up a lot more than 236.
The numbers you got on Thursday speak to pools and golf.
Right. It's a lot more than 236.
Right.
So if we can just talk about and look at those numbers. Thank you, Vice Mayor. Well, we'll have those discussions
right
here in a little while. So.
Okay. Councilmember James.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. Commissioner Rumke, under services for all other, what's everything that falls under the all other?
Hang on just a second. I can get you a complete list.
Okay. And if you're looking in the budget book, I can just turn to the page with you.
Well, what we did, and Jerry Southers helped us prepare this so that we could have the primary categories for your review. So hang on just a quick second here. If you look on page 3,
okay,
and then also it goes over to page 4,
okay,
at the top,
mm-hmm,
any item that is not listed as a bullet point up here is in the all other. So for example, let's see, ground leases, animal shelter collections, accident report sales, domestic relations collections. Those are just some of the items. So again, parking.
Okay.
That's what went in that other category. They were smaller.
Okay.
So we just capsulized those.
Linda, what page are you on?
I'm sorry. In the budget book, page 3 at the bottom, and then it rolls over to the top of page 4, and then it goes, subtotals to total services. That's what's captured on this particular slide. And so if it's not bullet pointed, for example, detention center fees, if it's under detention center, it's captured in that line.
Okay.
But anything that's not bullet pointed up there, Jerry and I worked together to try to make it easier for the council to be able to consider the highlights of each category. And by the way, and thank you for bringing this up, Councilmember James, I should have said at the beginning of the presentation, for every section that we're reviewing, the all other will be what's in that category, so we can open our budget book and you can see what's included in the all other. I should have pointed that out earlier. My apologies.
Okay. And so under all other there, building permits would fall under that?
Yes.
And how did you come to, what was the ideology behind the estimate there of, I guess, 800,000? I'm looking in the budget book on page 3. It's got an estimate of $800,000.
For
building inspection or building permits.
That would have been the projection that we were provided by our building permit folks.
Okay.
So,
thank you.
And Elizabeth would have that if you need it.
Okay, thanks.
You're welcome.
Thanks, Vice Mayor.
Councilmember Gordon's got a question.
We're just trying to follow along where you are. And so is that on page 4 of the budget book on the excess fees and collections? Is that what you're talking about? No. That's a $2.5 million number. What is that?
No. If you look at
on page 4,
yeah, on page 4 on the excess fee and collections under FY10 adopted is $2.15 million, and then if you follow that across to the FY11 estimate, which is the mayor's proposed budget, that's the $2.5 million. Those are the two numbers that you see up there. So we've got FY
so
adopted.
That's not-
And then we have mayor's proposed budget of $2.5 million in that particular category. Now, in your budget book, you've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 columns, so I know it's very confusing.
So what are excess fees is my question.
Elizabeth, what's in that?
To $2.5 million worth.
I'm going to let Elizabeth give you the 411 on that.
Excess fees come from the county clerk and the sheriff, based on their collections, they are entitled to receive certain revenues on the collections that they make for us. Anything above what we are allowed, they are allowed to keep, comes back to us. And likewise, at the end of any given term, their term of, you know, elected term, they return excess revenues back to us as well.
So is that entire $2.5 million is those two categories?
Those, just the sheriff and the county clerk are the only people who...
Okay, thank you.
Other questions? Okay, then we'll move on to the fourth section, which is the other revenue items. And coming back to Councilmember Lawless's question, this is where the sale of real property is enumerated, as well as obviously penalties and interest and all other. And with respect to the real property, and again, I don't know if, is Logan down here? As we're thinking about the real property discussion, if council wants to talk specifically about properties, et cetera, I think that's something that we would probably need to go to closed session just to protect the integrity of the property values. But there is not just this huge list floating around out there. We have looked at lots of properties for consideration. As we stated, that is a number that we felt comfortable with, that whatever combination of properties that the council ultimately decided on selling, that we could net the $4 million that we put in there. The other $236,000 is other property sales like vehicles and those kind of things. So I was advised that that's what we would need to do if we needed to have more specifics, and Commissioner Cole is here.
Okay, so last week, based on the fact that we were told that that is one property, do council members want to go into closed session right now to ask questions? And if you do, is there a motion?
I move we go into closed session to discuss the property.
Do I hear a second? All right. Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right. We're going into closed session to discuss real property sales. I move we come out of closed session.
There's a motion. There's a motion and a second. Motion by Councilmember Gordon, second by Councilmember Ellinger to return to open session. All right. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. We return to open session. Councilmember, motion to adopt the budget or adopt revenues. Oh, okay, yeah. That's fine. Councilmember Gordon.
Yes. Commissioner Rumpke, since you were on the sale of real property, as a revenue in our in the mayor's proposed budget of 4.236 million, I move that we ask General Services and Finance to come forward with a proposed list of properties that we can begin pursuing for sale.
It's a motion and a second. Is there any discussion on the motion? Councilmember Beard.
by doing this, are we going to feel comfortable that there will be $4 million available to us sometime during fiscal year 2011? Because if not, we need to pull that $4 million out of the projections, and then it can be a windfall profit for us or not without impacting the budget.
Okay. Did you understand the question?
I did. When we put the proposal forward in the, I mean, the line item forward in the mayor's proposed budget, we felt that as a placeholder, that $4 million with the combination of properties, we would be able to net it. So it's really, at this point, the decision of the council whether to pull it out and have that as a side item and recalibrate the budget with $4 million less in expenditures.
Take that as a yes, right? Right. That's the administration.
I won't be able to support that because I just don't think it'll happen.
Yeah, okay. But what you were saying was from the administration's point of view that that can be achieved. That's why it's in the budget, right?
That's correct.
Okay. All right. Any other discussion on the motion? All right, ready for a vote then. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no.
No.
The motion carries with the one dissent. Councilmember Beer, dissent. All right. We're ready to continue.
Thank you. This was the last category, and the only other information that I put in, again, for informational purposes today, Vice Mayor, just a reminder that the mayor, even though this is not a revenue item, the mayor's proposed budget did include tapping the rainy day fund at $5.87 million. That would require council action. So again, not necessarily for today's discussion, but that will be part of what the council will need to consider as far as balancing our budget for FY11. And then finally, and I know we've been focused on the general fund revenue all day, Bill did provide you the other major funds. Certainly happy to go through each item. Obviously, under urban services, the sale of recyclables, that was about $1.9 million. The sewer fees, we've had a lot of discussion about that. If you look at the MAP funds at the bottom, that's up $500,000 over last year. So those are other items that the council will need to consider. And I wasn't sure if you were focusing just on the general revenue today or not, but I wanted to make sure I brought this forth. And that's really all that I had for the council's consideration this morning.
All right. Any questions for Commissioner Rumpke? Closing questions? Yeah, Councilmember Feigl, then Councilmember James.
Commissioner Rumpke, at what point will we get into a more specific discussion about whether or not to tap into the rainy day fund?
Well, I think that'll be at the pleasure of the council. We certainly come prepared to have that conversation. I just didn't want it to be lost in the overall balancing of the budget, but it's certainly something we need to discuss. So I'd have to look to the vice mayor as chair of the CAL to determine when we would have that conversation.
Okay, thank you.
Councilmember Beard.
Now I can push the button. Are we talking about for this fiscal year or next fiscal year or both fiscal years as far as tapping the contingency fund?
We would tap the contingency fund at the end of this year to put into the fund balance for next year, should we need to. And then, or you can wait to do it.
Well, I mean, if we're going to have a $12 million shortfall or something less, we're going to have to find some money for this fiscal year, 2010 fiscal year.
We are, and we have carry forward that, and I'm happy to go through all of that with you, but we do have carry forward from previous years that's going to help us balance the budget. Obviously, it won't be structurally balanced, but it'll be a balanced budget.
Okay. Well, I just didn't want to lose the...
Right, the sequence of events, absolutely.
One other quick question then. So the balanced budget for the end of this fiscal year, is that including tapping into the contingency fund to balance the budget?
At this point, I don't think that we're looking, we're not projecting for that to be the case. The only comment that I make is we may want to draw it down in anticipation of using it, or we may leave it there knowing that you're going to have to use it at some point, but you will, in fact, have to vote on it as part of this proposed budget.
Okay. Thank you.
In other words, to balance...
FY11.
Fiscal year 11.
Yes, correct.
You are including...
Yes,
roughly
that
$6
is
million,
correct.
Dollars. Mm-hmm. Right.
And it could be less. It could
right.
be more.
Right.
So.
But it would be withdrawn at the...
As we would need it.
Okay. Council, actually, looks like that I didn't realize everybody was signing up on the monitor. But I'd called on Councilmember James, then Councilmember Lawless, then Gorton, then Stennett. Okay.
With the proposal of bonding things such as Rosie's and Lenny's, et cetera, and our urban service fees to keep our cash reserve high for bond rating, I'm having trouble justifying that with pulling $5 million out of our rainy day fund, which is a cash reserve. Can you explain why pulling it out of the rainy day fund rather than using cash for some of the purchases that we need to make in water quality and waste management?
Quite frankly, it's the balancing act, Councilmember Lawless, to not the appearance to the external rating agencies. If you took everything out of the contingency fund, for example, and you had and knowing that the purpose of the contingency fund is for a rainy day, for economic challenges that obviously we're facing as a government right now. If we drain it, let's say we took $14 million or whatever the balance is at this moment, all in FY11 to balance the budget, and there's nothing left in there. And I know sometimes this sounds illogical, but as the rating agencies are looking at us, then they look at that specific purpose dollars. Well, you have no contingency. And then they step over here, and it's almost as if, okay, this doesn't make sense, but okay, you take it out of urban services fund or another fund, and that's depleting the overall liquidity of the government. Well, we get slapped on the hands for that too. So what I've tried to bring forth to the council is a balance between utilizing other fund balances as well as utilizing the contingency fund. And I know it sounds illogical, but as you sit with the rating agencies, and I don't know if Ryan would have any other comments since he's sat with them many, many more years than I have, they absolutely look at all of the various aspects of where the funds are coming and where they're still sitting. And I'm sorry that sounds illogical, but that is how they look at it.
That's fine. Thank you.
Councilmember James, then Councilmember Gorton, and Stennett.
Thanks, Vice Mayor. Commissioner, does the money sitting in the contingency fund accrue money? Is it built interest? Is it on?
It accrues interest.
Mm-hmm. What's the interest that it accrues?
I can't tell you off the top of my head. Elizabeth, do you know what our... We can certainly get that information back to you.
Is it variable depending on the market or whatever?
Yeah, it is.
Okay.
It's invested in various instruments. Yeah, right. Well, I think part of it, there are other investments that it's sitting in. So.
And does the interest,
which should accrue, go back into that fund, or is it to a separate account?
It's supposed to go back into that fund. Yeah.
Okay. And what'd you say the balance is right now?
It's 14 and change. That's a little bit more than that. I'm sorry that I don't have that here in front of me.
14,470 maybe?
Yeah, 14,4.
As of June 30th, 2009.
That was last year. It's actually up to 15,800. I think it was 15,800 the last time I looked at it. But the year-over-year comparison, it was 14 and change.
Okay. Is it helpful in thinking about moving forward? Do we do like a 10-year, 20-year type of thing, a projected estimate of what the contingency fund will be so that we know whether a draw will even be possible? Do we try to predict that out 10, 20 years down the road?
Well, we can run projections at various interest rates. And the other thing, the other variable you have, Councilmember James, is the contribution to the contingency fund. So, for example, in this budget, we're not looking to make a contribution to the contingency fund. So it's a little dicey doing long-term projections. You can certainly put assumptions together. But if you, for example, if we had looked 5 years ago and we said, oh, well, in FY10, we're not going to put anything into the contingency fund, that would have an effect on the overall balance. But we can certainly run other scenarios with assumptions to bring back.
Okay.
But there will be that kind of variation in the number.
I guess where I'm going is that Councilmember Feigl mentioned something very interesting one time when I think Dr. Hackbart was here. And we were talking about contingency fund, and she mentioned that some states or cities have like 42, I don't know, it was like some amazing amount of money that was in a contingency fund. And we talked about what is the comfortable amount that we need to have in there. And I guess what I'm thinking is, are we looking at the contingency as more of a, are we looking at it from a withdrawal standpoint and what we'll be able to withdraw? Are we looking at it from a building standpoint of getting it to be a certain amount in order to be that safety net?
We're looking at trying to build on it, but the purpose of the contingency fund is for an economic situation like we're facing right now. So that's why we're bringing forth a request to withdraw. But the overall, at least from finances perspective, our overall vision is that we continue to build that because we're very much on the low end of our peer group with respect to the economic contingency that we have in place. So we're looking to build that, and it's like a savings account. It's there for that rainy day. And of course, if there's ever a rainy day, it's what we're facing right now. So,
well, the peer group that we were comparing ourselves to had a different tax structure than we have. I don't know that we found the peer group that is based off of payroll taxes.
I'm referring to our peer group within our bond rating.
Okay.
Forgive me, I should have said that.
Okay. We've had discussions before since I've been on council, at least last year, and about tapping into the contingency. And last year we had folks that were at the mic that said absolutely not. And whereas from some aspects, it felt like it was an emergency at that point. We were told, no, it really isn't. And we were given kind of descriptions of what would allow for withdrawal from it. What classification is assumed today? And what's different about now? And who determines, what is the state of it? What's the emergency that's causing us to have to tap into this?
Where we feel we are at this point in time is that there has been significant cutting, at least in my short tenure here. But if you look at the FY10 budget and what the council went through with respect to various plans on how to get the budget balanced, the recent expense reduction process where we feel that we've really cut expenses to the bone and programs to the bone. At this point in time, we're down to cutting services and eliminating jobs. And because that's where we feel we are. That's why we're bringing the recommendation to tap into this. The alternative is cutting deeper as far as program reduction and service reduction and eliminating positions, because if you remember, in the presentation I did initially for the mayor's proposed budget, such a large percentage of our expenses is personnel, so there's nowhere else to cut. So that's why I'm bringing that forward.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Vice Mayor. Thank you.
He says I'm next. As to the economic contingency withdrawal, $5.87 million, and just to Councilmember James's point, years ago, 10, 12 years ago, we did not have the current ordinance on the books that actually required contributions to the economic contingency fund, and so it was not growing. So if we had had a true emergency, we would not have had the money. Elizabeth remembers this. It was a very small balance, and so it's taken us quite a few years to build this up, this balance in our economic contingency fund, and there's been discussion over the years about what's a true emergency. And of course, I personally think, you know, the earthquake that's ready to happen on the western edge of Kentucky would possibly create a real emergency. And so I think some of the citizens ask, why would we use this money and not, you know, look at further cuts? That's the question that comes up. And so with this, the first thing is I would ask, did you all look at the ordinance very carefully in detail when you built the budget, and does this follow the economic contingency ordinance first? I mean,
the answer is yes,
like
we did.
Does.
Yes, ma'am.
And so the council would have to vote at the time this money was proposed to come forward. The council would have to vote specifically on this item, I believe.
That's correct.
And so is the thinking, was the administration thinking when you built this into the budget that at some point, maybe in the second half of fiscal year 11, that this would be looked at as to whether it's needed? You did not envision the council withdrawing this money at the beginning of the budget?
That would not be my recommendation to do that, because we can earn interest,
yes,
obviously, and we should wait to see, again, to the other conversations we've had, where the revenues are headed.
Well, to my way of thinking, the economic contingency fund would be the last thing we should ever tap.
I agree.
And so, as a council member, I wouldn't expect that motion even, or that proposal, to come forward until toward the end of the budget year.
The only caveat that I will add here, this is a number that changes.
Yes.
Obviously. Right now, because, and it's a crazy calculation, but right now, we are at the tail end of what the economic downturn would show in our numbers. So, and I'm sorry, I'm not articulating this very well. This time next year, the number may be lower, but the council has the ability to draw every dime down. So I wanted to take just 30 seconds to say that number may look different depending on when we look at it, but at the end of the day, the council has the authority to draw every dime out of that fund. And so if we came forth next spring, the calculation may look different, but you have the authority to draw as much as is needed.
And I think all of us pretty much understand that, and we understand that this is the number that you've projected that would be needed to come out
today
to build the budget. So that's really my only questions and comments. So thank you, Vice Mayor. And next on the list is Councilmember Stennett.
Thank you. I was going to follow up with Councilmember Gordon's question about when we withdraw from economic contingency. You're not planning on July 1, right? I just want to reiterate that.
No,
okay,
we do not.
You had said,
well, we had talked about doing that because of the amount, but as we step back, because the council has the authority to draw down more than what the amount is indicated, and unless law tells me different.
But by adopting the budget, I just want everyone to be clear, we anticipate drawing up to $5.8 million.
Based on what I've brought forth, that is correct.
Okay. And then, Vice Mayor, are we going to have the bond discussion today? Are we going to finish this discussion up? I know it's on our agenda. Are we going to stay here till noon? Very good. Thank you.
Councilmember Myers.
Thank you, Madam Chair, or Assistant Chair. I guess my question is, this budget has $10 million worth of one-time expenses in it to pay for essentially $10 million of reoccurring expenses. And what I really wanted to get to was the indebtedness. And when you go back to that presentation that you put up on the board for our underwriters the other day, mm-hmm. what happens 2, 3, 4 years down the road? The things that we approved for bonding back in October, mm-hmm. have we passed the point of being able to pull some of that back off?
Yes.
So everything we voted for is going to have to go through.
It's already, it was either reimbursable items, Councilmember Myers, where we had advanced out of cash balances and then the bond refunded those cash balances, or it was projects that have now already started with that, with those bond funds. Are you talking about what we actually went to market with? Let me make sure that I'm answering your question.
Well, on the list, have mm-hmm. we already gone to market with everything on the list?
Well, pardon me. I didn't mean to interrupt
okay.
you. We went to the market with, I think, approximately $64 million. I've got my list there of projects that you approved. And then if you think about last week, there were other projects that you had already approved but did not get funded. Those have not gone to market, nor are we proposing they go to market in this budget, so except for a couple items.
Okay. But the things that we did approve in October, we've already, the horse has left the gate, and we've got to carry through with all that. Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, does anybody else have anything?
Vice Mayor, I think...
Yeah.
If no one has any other questions, I think Jerry Southers was going to come back up and lead you through conversation just again regarding the revenue.
Right. Okay. Jerry. Hey, Jerry, you want to kind of tell us where we are?
Yeah, we've had the updates on April revenue for 2010. Then the commissioners made a good presentation on the revenues and assumptions that have been included in the mayor's proposed budget. I guess now we're at the point of where is council? I mean,
yeah.
How do we want to handle the adoption of revenue? Do we want to, my gut reaction tells me you probably want to take the major components and discuss those perhaps even a little further and then maybe vote on each one of those. And then if there's areas where you possibly don't agree or your comfort level is not there, maybe we may need to get additional information or defer it or whatever
so,
council sees.
Yeah,
fit.
Okay, let me summarize what you, I think you're saying, and this is based on a few conversations just now that I was having. Can we do it this way? Can we take a straw vote of who's in favor of including the rainy day fund or the contingency fund in the budget. Is that what you're saying? And including the sale of assets in the revenue number.
Well, can we get back to this page?
And where we're, you know, that'll give a sense of where we are in terms of comfort zone on those two issues.
It's okay. Okay, this page. This is the page, if you look at it.
That okay, so you're saying go through?
Yes, I would say like license and permit. You see the total there in the mayor's proposed budget is $219,874,280. And you see the primary drivers, revenue drivers, that are in there that the commissioners made a presentation on. We can take that total or that category of revenue and maybe do a straw vote on how council feels about that. Do you accept that? Do you want to make modifications? And then move down the list of the revenue items, and then hopefully we'll be somewhere at the end of the discussion. Now, will it be the total revenue that you've accepted with modifications? Will it have you, you know, adopted as proposed? So I think that's my recommendation of how we get at the
okay. The so let's say you get, hypothetically, that you get down through that, and then you're at the contingency fund and the sale of assets, and you say no to those, one or the other, or both. Then the next question is, where are you going to cut expenses, right?
That's right. And don't forget, this is the revenue portion that we're talking about of the mayor's proposed budget. If you don't accept either one of the two items, the rainy day fund withdrawal, or you don't accept the real estate sale, then you're looking at $10 million of expenditures that you're going to have to make up somehow. So we move in our subsequent meetings talking about revising expenditures. No, that's a good point. The contingency fund is not a revenue item per se. It is a source of funding, an internal source of funding.
Well, it's in the $269 million, isn't it?
No, it's not. No, it's separate. It's separate, yes.
Okay. Well, to get to $269 million, it's in there.
It's a fund transfer.
Okay, but to get to 269, you have to have that.
You have to either approve it or reject it.
Right.
It's not considered.
I understand. Right. Right. Councilmember James.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. I have a question about something that Mr. Southers just said. He said that if we do not approve a point of this revenue as it's presented, then we'll have to look at cutting expenditures.
Absolutely.
Is there not another option that we could also look at coming together with something around the council if we reject here that would actually increase revenue? I mean, is that another option?
Well, I mean, certainly that's an option, but there's not a whole lot of time. If to come up with a revenue item for $10 million or $4 million. You see what I'm saying?
Vice Mayor, I just to say that is we were presented just now with, you know, if you don't accept what's here, then you've got to cut expenditures. And I think we do have another option, and that is another option of increasing revenue. It will take time. But I think that is something that council should not put off the table, that just because we don't have another option in front of us right now, if we decide to vote down one of these options, we can still put all of our 15 brains together and think about other alternatives. I may not have one right now, but I think that's why we're here, is to be able to work together on coming up with something. So I'll offer that back to the committee. Thanks, Vice Mayor.
Councilmember Stennett.
I just want to clarify, the economic contingency is not in the 269. I want to make sure everybody understands. You said it's not in there.
It's not a revenue item.
Right. It's not in 269.
It's a source of funding, an internal source of funding. Right.
Okay.
But really, we're spending 274.
274.
This year. Right.
All right, okay.
And those are due to some of the increases in contracts, et cetera.
Gotcha.
And as far as adopting a revenue stream number, you know, our only option now is we have to balance a budget. We cannot pass a budget that is structurally imbalanced. So if we're going to lower revenues, we have to lower expenses.
Yes.
Or add another revenue stream in the budget. So, again, they have to equal each other when we pass a budget at the end of June.
All right, so we're really then not talking about the contingency transfer today to get to the 269.
Not in the 269, but in the overall budget it is.
Yes.
All right, well, let's go back then to your suggestion. This is the way we did it last year.
Yes.
We took it by category.
And I think we got to a point to where, you know, kind of the 80-20 rule prevailed, where we took 20% of the items that equated to 80% of the revenue and then basically approved the revenue.
All right, let's just go along. Let's just do it that way then.
Okay, the first you see is the license and permits. You see the primary revenue items in this particular category. You see the assumptions that were built into the mayor's proposed 2011 budget. So are there recommendations for motions? Or
Councilmember Gordon.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. I would simply make a motion that we accept the revenue projections for payroll, net profit, insurance, and franchise fees. Franchise fees.
It's a motion by Councilmember Gordon, a second by Councilmember McCord, to accept the revenue projections for payroll, net profit, insurance, and franchise fees.
Mm-hmm.
Is there discussion? No discussion? All right. Ready for a vote on that? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Motion carries.
What about the all other category under that?
There is no...
No, it's, let's just.
Oh, okay. It's not showing up there.
Sorry. Yeah, there it is.
That's my phone.
It's $4,086,000, $280 that comes back to a total of $219,874,280. That's what's in the FY211 budget under license and permits.
Could you tell us again what's in that?
You look on page 3 of your budget book. Forgive me. If you look at page 3 on your budget book, it would be all the items that are not enumerated under payroll, net profit, insurance, and franchise fees, such as contractor registration fees, certificates of occupancy, animal license, hotel motel license fee. Those are the kinds of things that are in the other category for that particular section. And that is on page 3, right in the center of your budget book. Bank franchise fee. Oh, no, I'm sorry. That's in the franchise fees. It's really those items that are at the bottom of that middle box.
Motion to accept the all other category.
Motion and a second. Motion by Councilmember McCord. Second by Councilmember Morgan. Gordon, would you repeat the Councilmember McCord, would you repeat the motion, please?
It's a motion to accept the all other category in the budget, which includes all the things she just had mentioned.
So there's a motion and a second. Is there discussion on the motion?
Does that include the sale of property?
No, sir.
No, it does. Yeah. All right. Is there further discussion? Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor of the motion, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Motion carries.
The next category is ad valorem, the property taxes. Included in the mayor's proposed budget is $20,244,000. If you remember, PVA was basically saying that property revenues would be, additional property revenues, property tax revenues would be relatively flat.
And there's a question regarding, Jerry, what's included in the all other in that line item as well?
Yeah, that would be the tobacco taxes, supplementary tax bills, miscellaneous type of things. You can see that on page 3 at the top of the page. Page 3 of the budget book, mayor's proposed budget. Sure.
I'm sorry, I missed it. Sure. Yeah.
I'm sorry, can you tell us if when we were voting for the total license and permits, and we were talking, and at the bottom it lists golf course collections and park and recreation programs, did that include the fee increase in what? No?
No, sir. No,
okay,
ma'am.
I just want to make sure.
Ma'am.
Okay.
It's under licenses and permits. Okay, Councilmember Gordon.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. I move approval of $20.244 million in ad valorem taxes be added to the revenue.
Motion and a second. Discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Motion carries. Jerry?
Okay. The next area is services. The FY 2011 mayor's proposed budget amount would be $20,669,050. And as you can see, it includes the MS collections, excess fees and collections that Elizabeth provided some background on, detention center fees. And now this would include the golf course collections and the additional fees in that, I would say. And park and recs programs, that's the swimming pools, and then, of course, all other.
Screen.
All right, Councilmember James.
Thank you. Thanks, Vice Mayor. Jerry, a couple of questions. When Mr. Hancock was up, he talked about that there's a list of programming things that will increase, and I'm guessing that all went through the links process, but I haven't seen that, and I'm interested in what those parks and rec programs increases would be, and I wondered if that list could be provided to us to see the detail on that. And also, when does the county clerk check come traditionally? And as you're coming forward, thinking about how, you know, is that going in a separate account? And then how do we know how that money will be used?
Well, the money goes to the overall general fund revenue. So it goes to fund generally everything in the general fund. There is a special account for excess fees. It is
42900.
Yeah. So all the funds for that are deposited in that account number, so we can clearly see what revenues are associated with excess collections. I believe they come in possibly quarterly, but I could double check on the timing of the deposits.
Okay, and those are up for grabs to use however we see fit?
They are not restricted for a specific purpose, no. We've historically just used them like we do all other revenues in the general fund to offset general expenses of the fund.
Okay, thank you. And And I've got another question, but I can't think of it. Oh, thank you. That's all I need.
Okay.
Thanks, Vice Mayor.
Councilmember Beard.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. I'm just curious about the EMS fees. Why would they go down $273,000?
We've got a resident expert taking a look at that.
Are we going to be a healthier community next year? Hopefully.
I haven't flipped to their actual projection yet, but I think generally speaking, it was based on actual revenues that we've been receiving this year. Let me see if I can. Yeah, they've just estimated. Part of that is based on the payments from Medicare for the runs that are reimbursed from Medicare, and it looks like they're having some issues getting some of those funds paid.
And then there's no rate increase.
Yeah, and there is not proposed to be a rate increase. Yeah, so it is strictly a function of how many runs we do and how the collections right. come in for those that have to be paid either through insurance or Medicaid.
So do we bill Medicare?
Revenue handles that, I believe. I'm pretty sure. And, yes, we do bill all insurances and Medicaid as appropriate.
Do we carry that as a receivable, Commissioner? Or
yeah.
So if we did, we could recognize that as revenue. Well, it'd be nice to have that cleaned up. Just, it's not a whole lot of money we're talking about, but it's just a little thorn in my side, I guess. Thank you, Elizabeth.
Councilmember Crosby, then Councilmember Feigl.
Well, I have another question, but I'm going to start because we just talked about the EMS fee with Medicare. Is there not an increase in what they, somebody said there was an increase built into the fee. I'm not sure if that's what they pay us or if, I know that it's not something we have to vote on as a fee increase because it's built in, but I recall somebody talking about this, but I can't exactly remember what it was, if it's an increase in what they pay, reimburse us?
I can't remember. I was out of the room when Bill was actually giving this part of the presentation, but what we were able to provide, and I emailed it, Councilmember Henson had asked about the actual rates that we're getting reimbursed, so I can email this to the entire council. But we do have that information, Councilmember Crosby, and happy to give it to you.
Do you remember if it was an increase in what we're reimbursed, or? Oh, okay. I guess I'm not real comfortable on that because we don't have all the information. And then also regarding the park stuff, I know that Councilmember Steen had asked some questions earlier that we've not received information on about numbers we got last week versus what we saw this week. So I don't feel like at this point I would be comfortable voting on either one until I have those answers. Thank you.
Councilmember Feigl.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. Actually, I wanted to follow up on Council Members Beard's questions about the EMS collections. And I think I asked this question last year, and I guess maybe I wasn't totally satisfied with the response. But what is our collection rate on EMS runs?
I don't have that information here, but I am happy to get that for you. And just a reminder to the council, I'm sorry I don't remember the company's name off the top of my head, but we had passed, or you all had passed approval of a contract for collection so that we could increase our collection rate, and this was one of the items that that company will be working on, Councilmember Feigl. So we can put that on our list to get that information to you as well.
Okay, I would appreciate that, too, because I know that we don't get 100% reimbursement for our runs that we make, and probably with the economy the way it is right now, that number is probably going to increase, the ones that we don't collect. So it would be very interesting to know what that number is. Thank you.
Okay, anybody else? Nope. All right, is there a... Councilmember Stennett?
I think Mr. Hancock does have some additional breakdown on the parking rate programming number.
Councilman Stennett, I apologize this morning. I don't normally live in Elizabeth's world of budget numbers. The two separate issues here. One is increases in the rates for pools and golf. I told you that the raising fees a dollar in pools would generate about $200,000. I didn't mean it would increase $200,000 our pool revenue forecast. It would generate about $200,000 in new money, in the same way that the golf fee increases would raise about $100,000. I didn't mean to imply that it would raise the golf revenue forecast $100,000 from last year. What you can see here is the 2010 golf budget was $3.8 million. The 2011 budget is $3.775 million. That's about $50,000 less than last year's budget. Last summer was an awful weather year. We had a tremendous amount of rain. Our revenues were way down. We hope to increase that with better weather, and with the dollar increase, we hope to get back to where the 2010 budget was. So overall, we expect to be about $50,300 from your budget package sheet over the 2010 budget. In programming, the 2010 budget was $1.4 million. I'm showing 2011 to be $1.660 million, or $236,900 more. That's made up, as you can see below, by about $160,000 more revenue projected in pools. And special events are going to increase $40,000. A couple of big events we're going to do for the public that will raise money, not by raising rates on anything. Kitty Capers is a demand-driven program. It's growing like crazy. We're going to increase revenue $17,000. Due to the budget cuts that we've presented to you all, we're going to eliminate the Little Goblins program. We'll lose $2,000 in revenue. And in rentals, with the new pavilion and other things in parks and the growth in our rental demand, we're seeing $20,000 there for a net in other programs of $75,000. When combined with the pool revenue increase of about $160,000 and the loss of $50,000 above, we're at about $235,000. That's what this shows, and I wasn't able to answer you properly an hour or so ago. So we are not increasing rates on pool or park programs except in aquatics and in golf, and it will net us about $236,000 in our programs. And as you can see in the golf course collections, 11 over 10, we expect it to be about $50,000 less than last year's budget.
Well, again, I mean, the golf courses collections are pulled out. They're separated, and we're still at $236,960 increase in revenue. And you have your pool number up there as $160,000 increase.
Right.
But, you know, if we base it on the I don't know who passed this sheet out last week. It says we have over 218,000 visitors to our pools, and if you increase those a buck, that's...
That was in 09. That was in 09 summer fiscal through June of last year. We're really a summer program, not a calendar program. So in order to take that into account, I'm projecting that pool revenue will increase about $160,000 over the previous year.
So if we don't approve the $1 increase, then pool revenue would not increase at all, basically, or be a lot less.
That's right. It'll be lower.
$218,000 lower. I'm trying to get a real number here.
I think if we raise pool admissions a dollar, we'll see $731,000 in revenue.
But if we decrease it or don't raise it by a dollar?
It'll be some number less than that.
We now have a ballpark. Is it the 218 that was passed out last week, or is it $200,000?
We do about 180,000 visits, and so standing here without putting a pencil to it, I think you would see something closer to 580.
Because the problem is we have to find that the whatever we don't use, we have to find it somewhere else in the budget to cut to get there.
I understand that. I think the proposed dollar increase is reasonable based on other swimming facilities in the community. We're talking about going from $3 to $4 and $4 to $5, much less than the cost to go to a movie. It's been three or more years since we've raised fees. I think our recommended increase is reasonable.
All right. Thank you, Vice Mayor.
All right. Anybody else?
So I guess we.
All right.
Would you entertain a motion?
Chair will entertain a motion on services. On this.
Services.
On services. Is there any motion to approve the revenue? No motion. Councilmember Gordon.
I'm thinking that, well, were people waiting for more information on the Medicare, Medicaid reimbursement issue for EMS? Council members?
I had asked for some information on what our collection rate is, but that really isn't going to give us a number.
Mm-hmm. I was going to go ahead and move that we approve the EMS collections, excess fees and collections, and detention center fees as projected. That's the first step.
Is there a second to the motion? Motion and a second. Is there a discussion on the motion? Councilmember Myers.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. What does all others include in that category? We might want to add that to the motion.
That is like parking, monthly rentals, computer service fees, administration collection fees, developer landscape fees, accident report sales. So there's a hodgepodge. You can see them. They start on page 3 of the revenue statement that's in the mayor's proposed. They start at the bottom of page 3 and continue on to pay on page 4.
That's an increase.
I will add that to my motion, all other. If the seconder will second.
Yes.
Mr. Stennett, did you hear the question? Is that okay with you? All right.
Good.
Is there a discussion? Councilmember Myers.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. Is there an increase in that over last year?
In the services, total services?
For others?
$242,134.
Is it an increase?
Yes.
Could somebody give us some detail on what that increase is?
If you look at the budget on page, on page 3, looks like the large items would be, I'm sorry, it's the excess fees is, well, in the other category here. Well, for example, adult probation fees, Councilmember Myers, is going from $85,000 up to $152,000.
Do we know what's causing that?
No, I can't tell you off the top of my head. Elizabeth, you don't have any notes on that particular item, do you?
Is it an increase in the fee, or is it an increase in the number of people having to pay the fee?
She's going to look it up for us. Thanks.
Thank you.
I'm sorry. Go ahead. Councilmember Gordon.
At some point, we were told that federal reimbursement for federal prisoners was increasing. Is that? That's not that account.
Okay. That's under the section you've already, the detention fees. Sorry. Another example, Councilmember Myers, while she's looking that up, if you look at administrative collection fees, it's gone from 10 to 17.
Two items. On the adult probation, the judges have raised the fees on that, but that's a function of the judges. It's their purview to do that. So a combination of increased fees and increased probationers are going in there. And then rents lease is another category that's seeing an increase. That's primarily a function of the Commissioner of General Services office being more hands-on in managing those lease contracts, getting fair market rates for the properties that we've decided that that's going to be our philosophy on.
And that's a good thing.
Would you like to repeat the motion, Councilmember Gordon, please?
The motion is to approve the revenues projected for EMS collections, excess fees and collections, detention center fees, and all other.
All right, hearing no further discussion, all in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Motion carries. All right, Jerry.
We're down to the other revenue items. And, of course, perhaps you may want to, instead of as a total, you may want to address these separate, especially with real estate. So.
Yeah, let's do that.
Yes.
Is there a motion on the real estate?
Move approval.
Motion. Is there a second? There's a motion and a second. We're dealing with the real estate question right now. All right, to accept it. Is there discussion on it? We've had a lot already, but is there more discussion on it? Councilmember Myers?
Is there a motion on the floor?
There is a motion and a second to accept real estate, the sale of real property. Right.
Okay. Without a plan on what we're going to sell and the likelihood that it will sell within this coming fiscal year, I can't vote for that. Thank you.
Does the chair need to yield in order to speak? Yes. All right. May I yield to the?
I asked him if he was going to give his opinion. Yes. Vice Mayor Gray.
Yeah. I think I've already stated it, but the reason that I favor this is because I think that we have the time, we have the window of opportunity during the next 6 months to examine this carefully and consider the options. And I think in order to get to the budget number that will move us forward, that gives us the time and it gives us the flexibility and the latitude to do just that. So that's why I'm supporting this. Thank you.
Thank you.
Councilmember Blues.
So you're thinking of this number with reference to the forthcoming list of all potential saleable properties.
Yeah, I think it allows us the opportunity, the time to do this in an informed way and in a thoughtful way, and to examine all the strategic issues as well as the financial issues that we have on the table. Right.
Thank you.
Councilmember James.
I favor this motion as well. I do think that we do have some time. I appreciate the opportunity for the council to be engaged in a conversation because we can deal with things like, you know, quality of life issues, needs in the immediate area, and we can take a holistic approach to what we have where and where we need other. And I think that's critical, and I think giving us an amount to aim for, working with the administration, I think this is a good way, and we all know that there's been a lot of conversation. I'd rather there be a process rather than just conversation about, you know, what property is to be sold. I'd rather there be a process. So I do favor this motion and hope that you choose to as well. Thanks.
Anyone else? All right. Councilor Myers.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I guess that raises an excellent point, is that there needs to be a process. And so my question would be that for those who are going to support this, if they support this, what is the process? I mean, I understand in theory that we have some time to think through this thoughtfully and all the things that have been said today, but who's going to make the motions that someone actually brings a list of properties before us that are going to be sold and then stays on top of that to make sure they actually go to market and are sold? Because what we're approving here is $4 million in our budget, that if that does not happen, then we're back at the same situation we were this last year, where the mayor comes up with a budget reduction plan and slashes $4 million from the budget. And I would rather that we look at what we want in the budget and make sure that the funds are going to be there to make sure that those things can be supported, rather than just saying we're going to put $4 million in here to sell a property with no plan of what property is going to be sold and how it's going to go to market and when. We heard conversations earlier waiting until January to assess some different things. I don't think that if we wait until January, there's time to actually sell a property in 6 months. So if we're going to support this, I'd like to see or hear from somebody what the plan is going to be to make it happen. Thank you.
Councilmember Gordon.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. That is exactly why I brought the motion when we came out of closed session, to ask General Services and Finance to bring us as soon as possible the list of properties that they are recommending for sale, so that we can immediately begin gathering that revenue, or at least giving ourselves a chance of gathering it. So, and that motion did pass. So with that, I'm going to support this, and knowing that before January rolls around, we will have a list and begin working on the properties.
Councilmember Blues.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. And I would add, I think that once we have that information, then we might, a second step then might logically be a joint council administration committee to work on, on the possibilities for making this number and looking at, looking at our options, bringing it back to either the full council or to a standing committee. In any event, I think that I think we do see a process in place here. Thank you,
Councilmember Feigl.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. I think that we've been talking for several years now about surplus properties, and we've never had the motivation to actually give it the kind of priority that it needed to have. And I think now we do. We certainly have the motivation to do that. And I think it's going to make us take a real hard look at everything that we have and finally be able to divest the city from some properties that we just really don't need. So I think this is a good process. It may be that number needs to be adjusted, but I do think this is the beginning of a good process and something that probably has needed doing for many years. So I'm glad to see this come forward.
Councilmember Beard.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. I'm going to go in the other direction on this. I don't feel comfortable with the $4 million at this point. I think there was too much reliance on the possibility of one property selling, and most of the properties we have that would be saleable, I believe we're already occupying, so we're going to be just swapping dollars, one-time dollars, for an expense stream of rents. And so I would, while I favor the analysis, I favor the sale of properties, I just don't think we can rely on it enough, and it would be nice to go ahead and take it out of the budget, make adjustments to the budget, and then if, in fact, they do sell, we just don't have to dip into the contingency fund as deeply. Thank you, Vice Mayor.
Thank you, sir. Councilmember Myers, you've already spoken on this once. Stennett hasn't yet, so we'll let him speak and then come back to you. Mr. Stennett.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. I just want to remind my colleagues once again that if we don't approve some type of number in here or don't approve the full $4 million, you know, that represents about 90 jobs in government. And we're already at year 2,000 operating levels in several departments. And I'm not sure, you know, if it doesn't pass, I would think that those voting against it would come forward with a plan to either reduce those jobs or reduce it in other departments. I know we haven't had our links report out yet, but $4 million is about 1.5% of our budget, and that's going to be a very tough cut to do. You know, I'd love to be able to save $4 million, Councilmember Beard, but at this time, day and age, that's a lot of positions in government that we're already at critical mass on. So I'll support it for sure after making, obviously, the motion. Thank you, Vice Mayor.
Councilmember Myers.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. I guess I would ask, Councilmember Gordon said that she made a motion that would start this process in flow. If you could put timelines around that so that we know what's supposed to happen, when, and who's responsible for making those things happen. Because I understand your motion, but the way it was made and passed, there's no teeth to it or accountability to making sure that it ends up happening in a timely fashion. So that's not a negative on your motion, but would like you to see, like to see when that comes out to full council for a vote, that timeline be put in there with names attached to who's responsible and accountable for doing each piece of it. Thank you.
All right. Anyone else? All right. Ready for a vote? All in favor of the motion regarding the sale of real property, including that in the revenue numbers for the budget, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Or vote, yeah. All right. The motion, has everyone voted?
Sure.
Motion carries. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 to 3. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Peggy, Councilmember Henson, did you vote? Thank you. The motion carries. All righty.
The next item on the revenue listing would be penalties and interest, and this generates from any penalties and interest where fees are billed, and if there's late payments or whatnot, if they're delinquent, then these are the penalties and interest assessed. And for fiscal year 2011, the number is $1,830,000.
Councilmember Blues.
What about the previous category, the golf course collections? Did we just leave that, or?
We just left it. We can go back to it, is what I think the intention is.
Okay. All right.
Or the option is. I'm sorry, Jerry.
That's okay. Yeah. You're right, we did leave it, but there may be a sense of additional information, perhaps, where you can go back to it and make a motion if you so desire.
I'm sorry, there's a question here. Councilmember Gordon.
Jerry, I'm sorry. We're on penalties and interest,
yes.
Correct?
Yes.
And is where in the budget, which page are we looking at?
It's on page 5. It's under total other income.
And could you
I apologize for asking you to do this again. Could you clarify what that increase reflects? It's a 52.5% increase.
I'll let budget people talk about that.
Penalties and interest is for any of the accounts where we have within the ordinance for a specific fee or service, if the payment is not made in a timely fashion, penalties and or interest may come into play. This is where the penalties and interest portion gets deposited. So the fees themselves would go to the accounts, you know, employee withholdings, any of the other accounts, you know, the developer landscapes fees, anything that may have a fee would get deposited to the actual account for the fee. The penalties and interest that have been accrued would go into this account.
So how was it determined that it would be up by 52?
It's based on historic collections. One note I do see on their revenue, the Division of Revenue makes this estimate, and because we are in the process of putting into place, I believe it was at work session whenever we had the aggressive collections, whenever that work session actually was. That's a factor in our ability to have more penalties going after people who haven't been making payments in a timely fashion will increase that number. Those sorts of things tend to be a one-year blip. You know, once you get people back in the programs, you don't get those penalties portions again, but that was their methodology.
Okay, thank you.
We don't have a motion. Take a motion. Chair will entertain
the motion.
We still
have a quorum? I guess we do. Yes. I move that we accept the revenue number of $1,830,000 in penalties and interest as listed under other revenue items.
Second.
Motion by Councilmember Gordon, second by Councilmember Lawless. Is there discussion related to the motion? Hearing none, we're ready to vote. All in favor, please say aye. All opposed, no. Motion carries.
And then the final.
Yep.
The final item is under all other, including the mayor's proposed budget, is $2,678,279. For 2010, the adopted amount was $6,100,000. There is a significant decrease, and it's primarily in 2010 what you had. It was made up of primarily $4 million, almost $5 million. $3.3 million came from the transfer of other funds, and that breakdown is like $1,025,000 from the mineral severance fund. $185,000 was transferred from coal severance fund. $1.9 million was transferred from the prisoners' account fund, if you remember. And then $185,000 was transferred.
Jerry, excuse me. What page? Where are you reading from? What page?
This was I had asked the question from budgeting to respond to the $3.4 million decrease between the two periods. And then I'm actually reading from a letter that Elizabeth responded. I got this late yesterday afternoon. I can put this overhead if you want to see
it. Can you put it on overhead? Overhead, that'd be great. Thank you.
Yes, yeah, thumbs. Okay, and on page 5 in the budget book, there's two primary areas that are driving this: the $3.3 million transfer from other funds, and the $1 million from the transfer from the landfill. It was a payment as part of the contract provisions, as I understand. The breakdown of the 3.3 million, you see it in the second section of Elizabeth's letter. It gives you where the funds were in 2010 that were transferred, and for 2011, obviously the amounts aren't the same.
Thanks, Mayor.
Okay. Councilmember Gordon.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. Okay. So, and did you say where this is on a budget? Is this on a budget
page? This is on page 5 of the revenue report.
Okay.
It would be under, it's the last two items on page 4 and the next two items on beginning on page 5. It would be under total other financing sources.
Okay, so this is money, it looks like, and tell me if I'm saying this incorrectly, this is money being transferred from Urban Services Fund, Sanitary Sewers Landfill. The transfer from other funds, is that dedicated special fee funds, or what are those other funds?
You see
those
the funds ones in the next
at the bottom.
Section.
Okay. So, and this is transfers that reflect what? In particular, those that are from dedicated fee and tax funds. How was that determined? That money needed to come out of those dedicated funds and go into the general fund?
For urban and sanitary, that is those funds paying the general fund for services that the general fund is providing, primarily things like LexCall, those sorts of services that those funds reimburse the general fund for. Engineering might be, it's not an indirect because these are primarily for employees who are being directly charged to those funds based on a percentage of their time that is being worked.
So basically, and is this in, this says transfers 2010 adopted.
Yeah.
This is the current budget?
No. What I provided to Jerry is an explanation of what made up that number for 2010. The primary difference between the 2010 adopted number and the 2011 proposed number is that other funds category, which we aren't seeing as the significant transfers in the other funds. The transfers in the dedicated funds are slightly different for 2011, but the primary driver of the decrease that you see in the 2011 proposed is the lack of those other funds being transferred in, because we've pretty well taken them down.
So on the first part, the dedicated fees and funds, the first three items, then does that 1.67 plus million, does that all pay for positions?
The $1 million is a separate issue.
The landfill $1 million?
Yeah. You can speak to that a little better than I can.
And I believe you might recall that Commissioner Taylor at the time talked about the contract we had with Republic. And as part of that contract, we received $1 million one-time payment. That's what that number is. And then the other two are, as Elizabeth has just shared, the full urban service and the sanitary sewer. Those are direct charges for direct people providing services that reside in the general fund, and they're getting reimbursed out of those specific funds.
So those do reflect 100% personnel cost.
I'll have to ask Elizabeth, is it 100%?
I think it is primarily personnel cost, but we can certainly double check that for you.
So, for example, the transfer of $326,000 from Sanitary Sewer Fund is to fund those people in streets and roads who work
with sanitary sewers 100%.
The people in engineering, well, not necessarily 100% of their time, but the portion of their time, correct.
Okay, and then help me understand again, the transfer from the landfill fund, what does that pay for? Does that also pay for people?
It just went to the overall general fund revenues. It wasn't underwriting any one specific thing. Unlike the transfer from urban and sanitary, which it is tied to people's salaries, the transfer from landfill is just a general source of revenue. It is not tied to any specific function. It's a one-time payment based on their contract.
But it's specifically landfill. It's specifically tied to the landfill fund. Is that, am I understanding that correctly?
It was received from the landfill contract, but it's not based on landfill fees, i.e. citizens paying for landfill services.
It's based on a refund of sorts. Is that what? Can you show that?
That was my understanding from Commissioner Taylor, but I can certainly get the details behind that. That was kind of when I was joining the urban county.
If you could show that in a flow somehow, help
sure.
educate us that it never has been money paid by the citizens.
Correct.
In their fees, that it's money that had nothing to do with the fee. I think that would be important to me and maybe
okay.
to other council members. I don't know.
Happy to
sure.
show that. But the other important point, and I know you're grasping this, is that it was a one-time part of a contract. So we wanted to make sure that we highlighted that. That's what I talked to Jerry about, that's why it was such a large reduction year over year. It's because we will not have that again.
I mean, does
FY11.
And it would be important, I would like to know how it's determined that that's not money that came from fees.
Okay. And again, I don't have the contract, but I can certainly go back through and enumerate for you.
Okay. Thank you very
Thank
much.
You.
Councilmember Lawless.
Thank you. I'm curious about the $185,000 transfer from 2006 Bond Projects Fund.
The 2006 Bond Projects Fund was a fund that is closed. All the activity in the bond has been completed. So the funds that were remaining in the bond, since general fund went to pay the bond, funds remaining in the bond come back to the general fund. But again, these were all transfers in the 2010 budget. They aren't anything that you are considering now in 2011. It's just to demonstrate why the budget in 2011 is so much smaller for transfers as compared to 2010.
Well, I understand that, but I'm still curious about what bond project funds.
I believe that bond may have been, there were many things in that bond. I think it may have been, what was left over may have been related to a construction project we were doing. We have notes upstairs, but all of the projects in the bond were completed.
Okay. I would like to see a list of those bond project funds, each bond, and what they were for and what they were ultimately used for. Thank you.
That's all I have.
Councilmember Stanton.
Thank you. And on the transfer from 2006, I believe it was the leftover money from Station 2022 bond that was transferred to the general fund to utilize design money for Station 2 relocation. But that was leftover bond money that we didn't spend. But to the question, I mean, if you add up all that, that's a lot more than the $6.1 million you have as a placeholder in the budget sheet. How do we go from $8.2 million to $6.1 on our budget sheet? Where's the discrepancy? I mean, that list adds up to a lot more than what was actually listed here as $6.1 million last year.
No, the total of that category is $7,479,000. This is just the $6.1 million is primarily this. And like I say, if you look on the bottom of page 4 and the top of page 5, you see it, you know, the total there is just...
We're just talking about all other right now. So that all other number, how much of that is the from the prisoner's fund account? Anything from that this year?
No.
Zero? Because in our link, Councilman Ellinger, I think we talked about money coming over from the prisoner's account again, or the telephone account.
But when this... Wasn't this the funds that had accumulated in that account?
Yeah, these are the...
So now the funds are being deposited in the general fund currently. And that was a bill that...
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry to walk in front of Jerry. That's exactly what I was getting ready to say. So the funds accrue, or the... We make deposits into these funds as the balance accrues when it gets to a certain point where it makes sense to move it. We move it over, and so there will be an accrual of the into the prisoner's account fund. Do we have that budgeted for this year? That there'll be deposits made into that, but I don't think it'll be of a significant size that we're projecting. Councilmember Stennett, what I was going back to, it's $4.89 million. That we're talking about, it's not whatever that is, 8.2 million. Don't add those two numbers together, because all we did was break out what the other funds were. So from the FY10 adopted budget of
6.1 even.
Thank you. Of the 6.1 million that was adopted, 4.989 is what's enumerated at the top. That we're just trying to give you some clarity, because we thought that council would have a question, obviously, of why is that going down 3.4 million, and we wanted to be able to account for you. Here are the specific items that were either one-time transfers, or we've swept the accounts and they're going to have very minimal balances, so we're not going to be able to use them in the FY11 budget.
So where's the difference in 6.1 and 4.9? Or is that 1.2 million?
Okay. It's in interest. Let's see. I've got interest. I've got forgive me, I'm going line by line here. If you, and I'm trying to get you a reference point so you can just look in your own book. If you look on page 4, right after total services, it starts with fines and forfeitures. If you go down, you'll see intergovernmental. Obviously, we took the sale of real property separately. You've got interest, so you've got total investment income. You've got total financing from other sources, and then you've got total other income. That's where those categories would be that would make up the difference.
Income and interest would
yes.
be 1.2 million on 5 million. Okay. My real question, though, on the 2.6 number that we have in the budget, you're saying zero of that comes from the Department of Corrections budget or phone money account?
I'm going to have her look it up.
They have
money in their individual accounts, and then when there has been, and Elizabeth, I don't want to explain this incorrectly.
We showed it as a transfer last year, but we're not showing it as a transfer this year.
That's correct. That's the best way to look at it.
And why the change?
Because I don't think that any we've let these dollars accrue in the past. And this last year, the FY10 budget, you chose to sweep as much as you could out of every single fund. So those funds had zero in them. And then this year, they're actually using those funds within the budget to make their expenditures, I mean, to be able to cover their expenditures. So instead of having it accrue in a fund balance, it's going directly into their
Yeah, I mean, I much prefer this year's way versus last year.
Right.
Okay. Thank you.
right, Councilmember Beard. And after Councilmember Beard, we're running up on a hard stop here for the next. There's some council links meetings that start at 1 o'clock, and people need a break between now and then. So I'm going to, after Councilmember Beard, the chair is going to discuss some options on moving forward with item number 4 on May the 20th. Councilmember Beard.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. On these transfers from funds, do we have a fixed philosophy and methodology on, from a cost accounting point of view, about justification of moving the money? And does that get refreshed as we go through the years? Or is that something that was done 5 years ago or 10 years ago and we're using the same methodology? Or do you know?
I know I'm new, so I don't have a lot of history, but the amounts certainly are reviewed year to year.
Right.
I would have to talk to Mary Pfister, who's only been here a couple more years than me, as far as the review of the actual methodology. Now, with respect to the direct charges, those are absolutely reviewed on an annual basis.
I understand that.
But
allocation of time, for instance, and
exactly.
Are people actually logging their time properly, or is it something that, oh my golly, I forgot to do it the last quarter, so I'll go ahead and fill this sheet out, and because I've been there and done that. Just wondered.
Well, I guess I'm going to have to defer to talk with Director Pfister, but in general, I would say that we've been using the same methodology at least the last couple years. I don't know beyond that. I'm not aware of a new methodology that's being used, but it's certainly something among other things that we're looking at. Particularly, we're at our next links, we're talking about indirect costs, and I'll be addressing that at that particular length.
And then the second question involves the prisoner's account fund.
Mm-hmm.
And I never have been clear how that money is created. It comes from the prisoners, and they deposit it, and then we keep it? Or are we charged them $5 for a telephone call when I can pick up the phone and call France for 4 cents? It doesn't
I'm
seem
so sorry.
Kosher
I don't
to me.
Know the answer to that.
I hope
I don't
you probably
know if
don't,
anyone in the chambers is here that could answer that question, but I certainly can get back to you on that. I'm just not clear as to how that happens.
It's serious money, and you know, it's one thing for people to have to be incarcerated, but to pay heavy Hyatt costs per night to stay in jail is doesn't make any sense to me. Thank you.
Councilmember Gordon.
I was just going to say, since the questions have come up about indirect cost and the dedicated funds, I would encourage any council members who want to attend the 1 o'clock link meeting, which is specifically to answer the questions we have had in our links, which is number one, how does indirect cost get determined and what's the methodology? And number two, what is the money flow from the time Kentucky American Water collects the fees until it gets back to the divisions? So at 1 o'clock, we're going to have those conversations with Commissioner Rumpke and I believe Mary Pfister.
I think she's
Director of Accounting. And I think it's going to be a pretty important discussion. That'll be on the fifth floor. Thank you.
Okay. All right. On May the 20th, Jared, we got anything else right now?
We need to vote on this, whether to accept
it. Oh, yeah. Right. Sorry about that. We've had so many votes today.
True.
All right, is there a motion? There's a motion by Mr. Stennett. There's a second by Mr. Ellinger. Is there a discussion? All in favor, please say aye. All opposed, no. Motion carries. All right, we know that we still have some blanks to fill in on revenue. We're just going to have to work with that. On May the we have our next meeting scheduled for May the 20th at 5 o'clock. Since we still need to address the general questions of capital and bonding projects, it's been suggested that we might move that meeting up to either 3 or 4 o'clock. There's a noise. It's okay. You're okay with that? No noise associated with that? Okay. Okie dokie. So if we can start at 3 o'clock, that'll give us pretty good time. 3 o'clock? Wait a minute. How many cannot do 3 o'clock on the 20th? Right now we have one scheduled for 5 o'clock. And we need, because we still need to get through lots of stuff. Councilmember Gordon, question.
So would the idea be at 3 o'clock we would discuss the capital, which we didn't get to today, and maybe the issue of the pool fees and the golf fees, which we didn't attend to, and then at 5 we'd move into the links report outs as scheduled, or what?
I think that makes sense.
As soon as you finished, yes.
Okay.
All right, okay. 3 o'clock. We're going to have, I mean, my view is we're going to have more time. So all in favor of 3 o'clock? All opposed, 3 o'clock? Well, all right, the 3 o'clock has it. So we will next convene at 3 o'clock on May the 20th. All right. Is there a motion to adjourn? There's a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye. All opposed, no. We are adjourned.